Over to Tejananda for day five of the dynamic, meditating in the dynamic mandala.
Day five. So day five is the area that we're going to sort of move into from, we did spiritual death yesterday. Well, I say we did it. We touched upon it. We brought an element of spiritual death in somatically speaking. We did a somatic exploration. And spiritual rebirth is, I suppose all of these areas from, you know, from integration, positive emotion and so on, all of them, all of these areas of our system of practice, you know, they do have correspondences in most principal Buddhist traditions, but Sangharakshita came up with his own specific nomenclature. And spiritual death and spiritual rebirth are really two sides of a coin. So spiritual death, as I said yesterday, is fundamentally, it's the practice of insight, if you like, the application of wisdom, prajna. So it's the application of insight practice. But an actual spiritual death is when one of the illusions that we are focusing upon in order to see through actually does drop away, either temporarily, even momentarily, or potentially permanently. Now, when a delusion drops away, there's a corresponding opening. It's just like, suddenly it's ordinary life. We're not in some kind of heavenly realm. We're not necessarily even experiencing a lot of bliss or anything, but it's just like we're seeing things. It's like with clearer eyes, we're seeing things without that particular illusion. And that seeing is the essence of spiritual rebirth. So it's a corollary of seeing through a delusion or an illusion, is that we see things to some extent as they are. So it's not necessarily a complete awakening. Most people will have had glimpses of this. Some people will have experienced longer periods in which, that there's a kind of ongoing insight. It might be that the sense of self just drops away for a period of time. It might be a few moments. I've known people to have that happening for some weeks. So in a way, that's the principle. Now the practice within the order, we have the sadhana, which is essentially a visualization and mantra recitation of a Buddha or Bodhisattva. And in a way, we don't have any real equivalent of that for non-order members. Everybody has access to the principle because anybody can see through a delusion or an illusion and open up or wake up to what is there without that illusion being present. But the actual practice of sadhana is, within our context, is within the order. However, I do have a couple of suggestions, because sometimes it's said that even if you're not, you don't have a formal sadhana, you can have a relation with Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. Yeah, absolutely anybody can. Most people, once they begin to get a feel for what these Buddhas and Bodhisattvas are, what they embody or represent or symbolize or manifest, once that's there, there can be a sort of opening to that quality through that figure. And of course, if you do pujas, we often chant mantras, and we often focus on mantras of particular Buddhas and Bodhisattvas. So that's there, and I'll suggest in a bit a way in which you could open up to that. I would say that if you do have a sadhana, then you can very much bring that into this stage in terms of the dynamic mandala, because the three stages that we've already been looking into or been practicing in an integrative way are, you know, if you like, they're the ideal setting up for sadhana. But if you're doing the this dynamic mandala approach, you just as with the other practices, we're trying to keep it very, very simple. I would suggest that the same with visualizing a Buddha or chanting the mantra at the same time. You just keep it honed down just to the bare visualization and the mantra. So you know, this is not something I'm going to go into because obviously it doesn't apply to everyone, but I thought I would just mention it. You know, because if you do a sadhana, then that can be part of this practice. Now, what we're going to do, as before, is we'll do a practice now in which we'll have a resume of that integrated approach, that integrated somatic approach, and then we'll come into the what we're dealing with, spiritual rebirth aspect. Yeah. And after that, we're going to explore another aspect of spiritual birth and rebirth. And again, this is something which could potentially apply to anybody. And the essence of that is summed up in the title of a book that I expect many of you are familiar with, which is After the Ecstasy, the Laundry by Jack Kornfield. Yeah. So what that book is about is the fact that, you know, people have insights, people have very deep spiritual experiences. People even feel that, you know, maybe they're fully awakened. And, you know, that can continue for a longer or shorter period of time. But there comes a time in which, if you like, our unresolved stuff catches up with us. Yeah. We really have to go into our stuff. So, you know, our stuff appears in the form of negative emotions, you know, what we call kleshas or afflictions. Craving, aversion, delusion, anger, greed, pride, you know, all of those things. So, you know, those are things that are going to re-manifest and, you know, spoil the whole impression that you're already fully awake. So, you know, we have to have ways of working with that. And I'm going to suggest a way which is, you know, just one way in which we can approach the afflictions, craving and so forth, from the perspective of insight. Yeah, so that's what I'm hoping we'll cover today. So let's just do that initial meditation, just to enter into the mandala, the dynamic mandala. And as usual, we're going to approach embodiment via bringing awareness to more subtle aspects of our posture. But first of all, as soon as your basic posture is in place, just sit, just get a sense of what's here, you know, what the current states of mind and body are. And by the way, when I say mind, I mean to include emotions in that. You know, so just be open to, if you like, your mood, your state, your emotional state, your body state, without trying to alter it. So for the last several days, we've been coming into the body via the head and then moving our awareness down. And you can experiment with this. If you want to, you can just simply come down to the sensations of grounding directly. That is the sensations of contact with the seat and floor. Or as we've been doing, you can take your time to become aware of the sensate head, the somatic head, the face and the rest of the head, and then move the awareness down the body more gradually. But the end result is the same. We reach the sensations of contact with the floor and the cushion or seat. And when your awareness is in those more intense sensations of contact, just let the awareness take it in, take in the quality of those sensations. I've been calling them intense. I could say they're stronger than some other areas of the body, but what is the actual immediate experience of those sensations? So sense these sensations are our contact with the earth. And let your awareness open out to the earth beneath. And as I've been saying, this is a sense of the earth as, you know, an energetic entity rather than a geological one. And then, if you wish, you can use the breathing up from the earth. So letting your out-breaths go down into the earth through the pelvic floor, into this energy, which is the earth, this chi or prana. And then on the in-breath, it comes back up through the pelvic floor, right through the core of the body, towards the spine, to the very top of the head. You can even sense it going above the head. And notice whether that brings a sense of energy and lift into the posture. To what extent are you experiencing the sensations of the body as energetic or vibrational, as alive? Even tingly? Just subtly check that your chin is not jutting out or pulled right in. So it's somewhere in between, and the head is just resting effortlessly upon the spinal column. And also check for any imbalance, left or right, back or forth, just by subtly moving, finding the point at which it feels poised. And then just let go of any tensions, contractions, holdings on, which you can let go of. There's likely to be some that are resistant, but just let go of whatever you can. And then just being the breathing body, having a sense of the whole cloud of somatic sensation. Which naturally will include sensations of breathing. So at this stage, we're simply looking to be present in experience, present in these sensations of the body. So notice to what extent the mind activity is dominating proceedings, or to what extent awareness is just embodied. So there are a number of possibilities. If there is proliferation going on, you can bring awareness to the breath, use the breath as an anchor. You can engage more formally, so to speak, with particular stages of the mindfulness of breathing, including counting. Or as I've been suggesting, you can bring awareness to the lower abdomen, the area known as the hara, which is just above the pelvic bowl, halfway between the navel and the pelvic floor, and in the middle of the abdomen. And just breathe into that area, breathe into that area of the lower abdomen. So always noticing what is helpful and pursuing that. So if you don't find the hara helpful, then you can attend to the body and breath in another way. Now bring your awareness to the heart, to the heart center. So generally, most people experience that in the middle of the chest, but sometimes it can seem to be lower down. I'm not quite there, so feel free to ask your body to reveal the heart center. And if you've been finding it helpful also, you can be aware of that area to the rear of the heart center, possibly a bit lower down. It seems to be quite distinct, but at the same time connected with the qualities of the heart. And then just with awareness in the heart, connect with or open to a sense of kindness or goodwill, benevolence, well-wishing. Just open to the possibility that that is already here. All you have to do is open your heart to it. Or open your being to it. So notice whether there's any heart response to this quality, which is metta. don't assume there will necessarily be a kind of ignition of the heart. It may or may not happen, but you can still be in contact with the metta. And then just letting go of any limits to it. Don't assume it's just there, as it were, for or in you. Let it be boundless, all inclusive. And then very subtly open your awareness to the whole sphere of somatic and other experience. And be aware of the cloud-like nature of the soma, of the sensate body. In the sense of being arrayed in space, these sensations are like the droplets within the cloud. And the somatic space having no clear edges. And no obvious limits. And then as yesterday, you could bring in sounds and sense that the sounds are arising in the same space. You could say that space is awareness, but it doesn't matter what you call it. There are sounds. There are these somatic sensations. All happening in the same space. And just look for any separate inside and outside in this. Can you let go of the notion that some sounds are outside, some are inside? Or that these somatic sensations are necessarily inside as distinct from outside? Maybe inside and outside are just conceptual impositions that we place upon our experience. So see if you can just experience as it is without those impositions. It's possible that a glimpse of that does emerge, or more than a glimpse. And if it does, just note it, be aware of it. At that moment, you may well be opening out to a more direct, a less deluded awareness of your actual experience. And that will correspond with spiritual rebirth. But it's not something that you can volitionally make happen. Okay, now just drop any sense of doing and just sit. Okay, so any comments or observations on the practice so far?
Could I say something, Angela?
Yeah.
Oh, hi. I really kind of related to what somebody said the other day, I think it was Keith, about outside sound and inside sound. I don't know who it was, actually. That somehow in one's experience they are different. And I was holding that belief. And today I was just noticing actually that it's just that there's qualitative differences perhaps, but then there's qualitative differences in a more distant outside sound and a nearer outside sound. So, oh my goodness, that just kind of became a bit clearer that there's as little difference in those as there is between a perceived external sound and a close outside sound. I mean, those boundaries are just conceptual, really.
Well, I mean, you can just reflect on the fact that all of those sounds are heard in your inner ear. Well, I mean, ultimately I suppose they're heard in the brain, but it's like whether it's a far sound or an ear sound, in a way it's all in the same place. And it's just the mind which is saying, oh, these are inside sounds and these are outside sounds. So it's quite clear in a way that it's something that we're imposing on our experience. And if you can let go of that, quite almost immediately, you have a sense of it's just a space, an undivided space in which sounds are arising. And, some of them are faint, some of them are loud. And the mind is probably going, oh, yeah, that's inside, that's outside. But you don't necessarily have to believe what the mind is saying. In fact, it's a very good idea not always to believe what the mind is saying.
Okay,
anybody else got a comment?
Yeah, hello, hi there.
Hi.
A similar experience, actually. So on the one hand, there was the outside, which was sound of traffic. And then I had a very similar experience, but it was kind of internal, but not a sound. It was the sensation of heat. It's a hot day and hot in my room. But then I noticed just before, what would be the habitual response to that would be then, you know, the I am hot, uncomfortable, etc. I noticed that just before I kind of gave that whole level of interpretation on it. And actually the sound of the car, the external, and the sensation of the heat, they both had, you know, they were both just sensations, impinged. And it was quite interesting then actually noticing the space where I would normally jump in and then say, I am hot, da da da, uncomfortable. Yeah. Just noticing both just kind of arrived, perceived, but actually there was a space, more of a space there, which was quite interesting.
It is, yeah. Well, it sounds like you are sensing it in a more direct way, so to speak, with less conceptual imposition on it.
Yeah. Still quite hot here, though.
Well, I wish it wasn't. Thank you. Never mind.
Thank you.
Hi, I'd like to say something. It's Sandy.
Hi.
Hello. Yesterday and today, I think I get caught in Vedana, that some sounds I have quite a somatic response to, in terms that I'll actually almost jump because they're jarring. Other sounds are soothing, like the bird song that I can hear from your end. So, just observing that's the point I seem to be at.
Yeah, well, sure. I mean, in a way, everybody is, because, you know, I mean, if there was suddenly a very loud noise here, I'd probably jump. And you know, it's quite natural in a way for the body to do that. But I mean, you can also, with things like that, you know, the mind says bird song nice, sudden loud sound not nice. But if you let go of, you know, those labelings, it's just like, well, if there is a sudden loud sound here, we sometimes get, you know, low flying jets coming across, you know, and it's quite sudden, and it can be very energizing. It's just like, whoa, and you know, you're really present. So, you know, it can be a matter of the way in which you're characterizing this as desirable and that as undesirable. Mm-hmm. And that's very interesting and worth noting. Yeah.
Okay, that's useful. Thank you.
Okay. Gosh, time is going very quickly today. The trouble is every day there's more and more to add on, so to speak, in the leader. Any other comment?
I'd say something, Tejananda, about the experience of discomfort or pain.
Yeah.
Because I had the sense yesterday, and again today, much more, that of it as an artificial boundary that I was creating, you know, that there was a sense of space.
Yeah.
Then there are also points where there was a boundary, and when I sensed into that, it was a bit of discomfort or a bit of pain. If I just let it be for a bit, it kind of became less important.
Yeah. Well, that's interesting. I mean, also, we let's say with pain, I mean, this is something that everybody experiences to a greater or lesser extent. You can really let the awareness go into it and look for, well, where exactly is the pain? Yeah. I mean, is it, you know, sort of, well, I don't know. I mean, it's difficult to describe, but, you know, it's just like, well, you're looking for the location of the pain and you find probably a whole mass of sensations around that area. And it becomes quite difficult to pinpoint where the pain actually is. And then, of course, if you also stop conceiving it as pain and just conceive it as, well, experience it as what it is, which is sensation, again, that has an effect on your experience of it as pain. You know, so, you know, there are various ways in which you can sort of relate to pain, and you get more sort of insight into how the mind is actually creating, well, you know, often through resistance, of course, you know, is creating something which is more painful than it needs to be.
Yeah, I had the sense of it changing or else disappearing.
Yeah. Well, it does. And actually, that's a very good intro to the last bit of what I want to do with you today. So I spoke about an aspect of spiritual rebirth. Is in general, this area is working with our stuff. You know, after we've had some kind of seeing through or some sort of insight. It can be, actually for a period of time, it can be blissful. Certainly we feel kind of on top of things. And then, as I said, it's just like at a certain point, suddenly you get angry or, something happens and it's just like, oh gosh, all those things, they're still there. So-called negative tendencies. So one way in which you can approach this, well, I mean, there are several ways, of course. One way in which we approach these negative emotions, these kleshas, is through practicing ethics, the precepts and so on. So there is that ethical approach. We're also approaching them through meditation, because when we do become settled, when the mind settles completely, the kleshas become inoperative, but they're not gone. Yeah. So what we're going to do in this case is use an insight approach to kleshas, to negative emotions. We're actually going to cultivate one and then have a look at it. Yeah. So there's a certain kind of, you could say there's a certain danger in doing this, because you might just go completely incandescently angry or something, but that usually doesn't happen, because it's on the basis of the integrative mandala so far. So we've got embodiment, we've got positive emotion, we've got this sense of not being bounded or not being sort of a separate entity in the way that we usually conceive of ourselves. And that's a very good basis for looking at the kleshas, looking at the afflictions. Yeah. So what I'm going to suggest is that just for a few minutes, you think of, let's say you think of something which is irritating, or somebody who is irritating is probably more helpful to still, or you think of something that you really would like to have. Yeah. So basically those two are the areas of desire and ill will or aversion. Yeah. So you think of something that you can have a bit of aversion to, or you think of something that you can cultivate desire for, and you just allow that to work itself up. In other words, you proliferate around it. You allow prapancha to happen, and notice what's going on. Okay, so we'll just do that as a short exercise. So just close your eyes. Oh, there's more to this than just cultivating it. We're going to look into it as well, of course. So just decide whether, is there something you can immediately bring to mind which you find a bit irritating, or, that makes you cross, or at the other pole, something which you really, really would like. Could just be the end of lockdown, for instance, but there might be something more particular, like chocolate. So choose your closure and go for it. Just think about it, get into it. So we're trying to produce an actual emotion here, an actual negative emotion. and judge for yourself when it's gone far enough. If you feel it's going too far, then come back into the body, come back into the metta. Okay, so as you're thinking around this, proliferating around it, notice what's going on in the body in relation to it. What feelings are arising? And when you feel that you've got a genuine emotion going, what I'm suggesting is that you cut out of the mental proliferation by bringing your awareness very strongly into the sensations, into the Vedanas in the body associated with it. And just keep your awareness quite strongly on those sensations, in those sensations. And you may well find that they're unpleasant, but nevertheless, keep your awareness in those sensations. Keep coming back to them. Now, are those sensations, are those Vedanas actually angry or irritated or desirous? If you keep the proliferation from turning up again, are those sensations anything other than just unpleasant sensation? And if you keep your awareness with them, notice what happens with them. Again, without returning to the proliferating thoughts. Okay, so that's a short try. Well, I call it the pleasure bhavana. So, any remarks or comments on your experience there? What did you find?
Hello, Joe in Scotland here.
Oh. Can you hear me? Yeah.
Hello.
I can't see you.
I was thinking about picking slugs off my vegetables. It's like I can touch them now, but before I didn't even want. But as soon as I'm touching them, I just have this sense I've got to throw them over the fence as quickly as possible. So I kind of tried to think of having this thing on my hand for longer than immediately getting rid of.
Yeah, well, that's a good example.
So the thinking, the proliferation was actually saying, "There's not. This is fine. So it was interesting. It was in a kind of very instinctive revulsion sort of level. It wasn't a thinking.
Yeah.
It's just, it's almost like I don't understand or know about this thing and I perceive it as dangerous, so it must be gone.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
So, but the Vedana, the sense of a slug crawling on my hand, was just deeply, deeply kind of horrible.
Right.
So,
yeah.
I don't know, quite a strange one, because it was almost like a really kind of instinctive, primitive sort of level that this thing has got to.
Yeah.
I can touch it, but for no longer than I can possibly stand to just
Sure. over the fence. Yeah. Well, I know what you mean. Now we do have those kind of reactions, you know, because, I don't think a slug can do you any harm at all, but... You know, it's like there are insects and things which could do. So it's like the body reacts.
Yeah.
But you know, the part that I'm pointing to is when the mind goes, "Eh, slugs." I mean, you know, people who weren't Buddhists would probably kill them. Yeah.
Yeah.
So it's just like it's that that revulsion that you're really looking into.
But it's almost like the rational mind was saying, "This is not a problem here. This is okay. It won't do you any harm." So it's kind of weird. Something.
What happened in your body?
Well, nothing really, because I didn't have a slug in my hand.
Well, just on that, I mean, just consider the sensation of a slug on your hand without the concept slug. You know, might be very similar to, you know, if somebody else was stroking your hand in a rather delightful way.
Well, I'll try that tonight when I pick them up.
Anyway, anybody else got an observation here?
Yeah, I took my mind to a familiar situation where I felt quite angry. And there were two things that came to mind, as you mentioned. There's a physical reaction, a tension in my throat and chest. And then like the tape recorder was turned on and this script started running about how rotten it was and all the rest of it.
Yeah.
And then, as you suggested, letting go of the script and concentrating on the sensation, I was able to see that it was just this tension here and that, heart rate being more rapid, in themselves not particularly unpleasant. They were just there as they were. Mm. And then interestingly, as a follow-on, when I decided to say something on screen here, I got another physical reaction of the, of the anxiety to that, the physical response,
yeah,
to that, another tension and
yeah,
that, right? But they were just that. They weren't, you know, things in themselves.
Yeah, exactly. So it's just like, I mean, this technically it's what we call sankskara. You know, it's when we bring two things together, which on their own are kind of fairly innocuous, and we come up with something which seems like it's a fairly solid, substantial emotion. Yeah, and what we're doing here is kind of doing the opposite of kind of taking it apart and experiencing the body aspect on its own, separate from the mental aspect. Yeah. So it's only when those two come together that we get a negative emotion. But when we take it apart and we look into the body, what we find is just sensation. Yeah, just pure sensation. Unpleasant sensation, no doubt, but it's not actually an emotion. Yeah. So in that way, you can begin to see how, taking it the other way, how we make emotions up, how we create them and sustain them, because they seem to have their own reality, especially with emotions like anger. They seem to be very, very kind of objective in a way, and by looking at taking it apart in this way, we begin to see that they don't have any real objective existence at all. In fact, they're quite empty.
Yeah
Anyone else?
Yeah, could I say something about at the very beginning of that? It was just really helpful, I think, to see myself trying to create this emotion. It was quite difficult for me, whereas actually the emotion is something that's kind of intrusive often, the particular situation I was thinking about. And I think that in itself told me something really interesting about the reality of it or something.
But
I thought, well, if I can't actually conjure it up, why am I letting it be such an intrusive, real thing in my life?
Well, that's a very, very apposite reflection. I mean, it's well worth pursuing that sort of reflection, and you know, and doing it when you have an emotion come up, which, you know, which is not so strong as to be overpowering, but it's definitely some kind of negative emotion. I don't particularly like that term, negative emotion, but I can't think of a better one. Yeah, you know, so it's some kind of negative emotion. Then you can look at it in exactly the same way. Yeah, or you know, if it's come up in relation to somebody else, you might need to get a bit of space. But after, you know, afterwards, you can again look at what happened there and you know re-evoke it to some extent and look at it in the same way. You know, why and how does this come into being at all? Does it have any substantial, necessary existence or not?
Thanks.
Tejananda, hi. When you stay with the sensation of craving, let's say.
Yes.
And you just sit in the body with the sensation. I can't really find whether it's pleasant or unpleasant. I got a bit puzzled at the end of your lead, where the sensation was just, the alive sensation.
Yeah.
I couldn't really get back to whether this was pleasant or unpleasant. Uh-huh. So in the body, I couldn't label it anymore. There were just alive bits.
Sure. Alive bits is descriptive. So I mean, those sensations aren't necessarily unpleasant. Usually if it's to do with craving, we feel that it's pleasant, although if you go into it, it's not always as pleasant as you think it is. But you know, in the end, they're just feelings. Yeah, and as I was saying in relation to pain, it's the same thing. It's just like, well, you know, the mind is saying it's unpleasant, but then it's kind of just sensation. Yeah. So it doesn't matter too much whether it's pleasant or unpleasant. It's just really focusing on the sensations that are there when you have that emotion. Or, you know, any kind of negative emotion. Got time for one more, maybe?
I could say something, Tejananda. The two exercises, the one on sound and then this one, it's very interesting. The sound one, there was kind of agricultural machinery noises, which felt I wasn't engaged with. They just kind of passed through me. But then my children in the garden suddenly created a whole sort of, suddenly I was in my head again, and there was like much, you know, I just saw the attachment there really, really suddenly. And then the klesha one, it feels like that's related to, I just think I've seen, it's hard to articulate it, but I feel like I've seen something about the connection between attachment and the ferocity of the kleshas. So that's just really interesting, and I'm probably not making any sense, but thank you.
Pleasure. Well, I mean, attachment is a very strong one, and the same applies. It's like, I mean, it's natural to, in a way, to feel attached, but on the other hand, it's not particularly helpful. And we get attachment and love kind of confused a lot of the time. Yeah, so there could potentially be love without attachment. Anyways,
thank you.
That's all right. So we're time is up. So yeah, with this kind of approach, I mean, do feel free to experiment with it and see how it goes. It can be very, very helpful. I've certainly found this sort of approach very helpful. But I wouldn't say you necessarily need to sit there and think, okay, I'm going to get into a positive emotion, a negative emotion now. Just when it comes up, when there's something there, at that time, you can look into it. Yeah, and obviously we've got the basis of the precepts, but sometimes it is actually useful to let the negative emotion be there and have a jolly good look at it and see what's really going on. Okay, so I think we better leave it there.